Ladies and gentlemen, here to present the art and science of Laika, please welcome to the shape stage Laika's visual effects supervisor, Steve Emerson, and director of rapid prototype, Brian McLean.
Hello, hello. Thank you guys very much for having us. We're extremely honored to be here. We're going to go through a little presentation to help describe how we make our movies. We are only two people of about 450 people who work at Laika. So unfortunately, we're only going to be able to describe a little bit of what goes into one of our movies. But first, how many people here know about Laika? Great.
Okay.
So we have a little video for those people who aren't too familiar with Laika, what life is like up in Portland, Oregon at this little studio. So I'm going to play that video right now.
When you walk down the halls of Laika and you enter any set of curtains, what you enter into is always going to be a complete surprise, and it's going to be completely different.
It is absolutely true that every new movie that we make gets that bit more ambitious.
We want to make films that push this medium that we love, animation, that push it in new directions.
And we're moving in directions that stop-motion animation doesn't normally go in.
And so every film demands something new, but everyone's up for the challenge.
We've got a brain trust of brilliant creatives here.
We have people who are sculpting puppets. We have people who are making sets. We have people who are animating all day long.
And I think that's what's cool about this place, is it's this tactile wonderland.
Do it practically in camera is something we try to do as much as possible. But at the same time, we bring cutting-edge technology into the process.
Whether it's science or innovation, it's worth the risk sometimes to go out on a limb.
And with each successive film, we all work and grow as artists.
We really wanted to find a way to push facial animation beyond what we'd ever done before.
And the subtlety and a range of emotion.
You get totally transformed into the story and you forget that you're watching a little 12-inch puppet.
It's hands-on, it's tactile, there's a life to it that most other animation forms don't have anymore. We're a group of really talented artists who want to do it the best that we can.
Here at Laika, the energy, the atmosphere just really crackles with that creativity.
We don't have to be limited in the stories that we tell. That's what's exciting about the studio.
It feels like we really are just scratching the surface of what this art form can do. And that's incredibly exciting to me.
So over the last 11 years, we've made four movies, Coraline, Paranorman, The Box Trolls, and Kubo and the Two Strings. And we're just finishing up our fourth movie, Missing Link, and that'll be coming out in spring of 2019. And Steve will talk a little bit more about that later. But right now, I want to just get a show of hands. Who here has seen any of our films? Who's here seen Coraline? Paranorman, Box Trolls, Kubo and the Two Strings. All right, who has not seen one of our movies? All right, you guys don't realize this, but by sitting through this presentation, you have agreed that in the next 30 days, you have to watch all four of them. Agreed? All right. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do facial animation at the studio. My title is a director of rapid prototyping. That's kind of a crazy title. Doesn't make much sense, I'm sure, right now, but hopefully at the end of the presentation, it'll make a little bit of sense. So what we are basically doing is we're using an age-old technique of replacement animation, and we're fusing it with 21st century 3D printing technology. We were the first studio to do this on our film, on the first film we did, Coraline. And the idea was pretty simple. We take this technique of replacement animation that was really successful in a movie like Nightmare Before Christmas. Nightmare Before Christmas, the main character, Jack Skellington, had 800 hand-sculpted replacement faces. So that meant that an animator would be out on set, they'd be moving Jack Skellington's body around, they'd take a picture, and they'd pop off one of his heads, and they'd grab another one and with a slightly different expression, and they'd stick that on, and they'd take a picture. And gradually, when you knit all those images together of replacing one expression after another, you get the sense of movement. So we had this idea of, what if you were to take that technique that was over 100 years old and fuse it with 21st century 3D printing technology? So basically, we'd be able to animate the faces in the computer and then send them to these wonderful, brand new 3D printers that would produce them as a physical object. So it was a crazy idea at the time. The 3D printing companies we were using, one was called Stratasys, is Polyjet technology. The printers would only produce one color of resin. It was a white resin. It meant that every single Coraline face and every single face on that movie had to be hand-painted. So we produced 20,000 faces for Coraline and the whole movie Coraline, and we had a whole army of painters that were going in there and having to hand-paint the lips, having to hand-paint five freckles on one side of her face and five freckles on another. And if they screwed up, if a freckle was painted in the wrong spot, through replacement animation, as you were watching the screen, you'd see these freckles sort of buzzing around on her cheek, and it would look really unnerving. So the painters not only had to be really exact in placement, but they had to be really exact in color. So we were constantly sort of battling how complex we could make a character's design. We knew we had come up with something amazing of using these 3D printers, but we were constantly having to tell the director, no, you can't have six freckles on her face because that's going to cost X number of thousands of dollars of a painter's life of putting on another freckle. So on the next two movies, Paranorman and The Box Trolls, we had this idea of shifting to this emerging color 3D printing technology. So we were using a 3D Systems Z-Print powder-based printer, which allowed you to print in full color. So all of the faces on Paranorman and Box Trolls were colored in the computer ahead of time, painted in the computer, and then they would come out of the printer in full color. But because it was powder-based, it meant that the faces were extremely fragile. They'd come out of the printer, and they were like chalk. If you were to drop them, they would shatter. If you were to bump their noses, they would flake off. So you had to take these faces, very carefully carry them around, sand them to get rid of any of the build lines, and then you'd have to dip them in a super glue. And the super glue would suck into the face, and it would harden the face. It's a little bit like varnishing wood. It sort of really brings out that color.
Awesome!
So we continued to use the plastic printers, the one that I told you we were using for Coraline, we continued to use that for all the internal mechanisms. So not only is the RP department responsible for designing and engineering and animating the faces, we're also designing and engineering all of these different pieces that make up the inside of a puppet's head. And this is eggs here. Everything you see was 3D printed, except for the nuts and bolts. Those were off-the-shelf hardware that we would incorporate inside a head. So I think eggs had something like 60 to 70 custom engineered pieces that make up the inner components. And every puppet you see over there, if we were to pop off the faces, and I'll do that after the show, you'll be able to see how complex the characters are. Now this technique, we were really proud because in 2016, this technique, the studio was awarded a scientific and technical engineering award for pioneering the use of 3D printing technology in replacement animation and stop motion animation. And unlike a typical Oscar award where it's tied to a film, this is actually tied to a process. So what this means is it means that we had to convince the Academy and convince the film industry that what we were doing up in Portland, Oregon was having a lasting impact on how movies are made. And they actually would send down a team of investigators, and they wrote a 100-page paper on the process. And it took over 2 years of them investigating it to award us this award. So we're really proud of that. Now, right around this time, right around the time that we had won this award, we started doing work on Kubo and the Two Strings. And we had just been so successful in, you know, getting the Academy and getting the film industry to recognize that we had created this great new technique. And then suddenly, I'm going to actually first play the video of the trailer of the film. But before I do, I want to talk a little bit about some of the character designs that we had in the movie were really nerve-wracking because we had just done all of this wonderful work with pioneering this new technology, and then suddenly we had these character designs that we had no way of actually producing with this technology. So we had to find a completely new way to do it. So now I'm going to play the trailer for Kubo and the Two Strings. I think most of you guys have seen it, but for those of you who haven't, here it is.
If you must blink, do it now. Pay careful attention to everything you see. No matter how unusual it may seem. If you look away, even for an instant, then our hero will surely perish. It's time to follow my own path. My name is Kubo. This is my story.
Your magic is growing stronger, but when we grow stronger, the world grows more dangerous.
Got my attention. I promise I won't even blink. I actually don't think I even can blink. Do I have eyelids?
So these three characters gave me sleepless nights. Not because they're scary, but because their facial features were extremely challenging for the technology that we had. Remember I was talking about the powder printer and how fragile that was? Well, each one of these characters either have fine hair around their face or they have really sharp angles, sharp, tiny little features for noses. And we knew that we may be able to produce one face that looked amazing, but would we be able to produce faces that would hold up for replacement animation? So we were at a crossroads. We either needed to go back and tell the director, hey, can you change your character's design? Or is there some other technology out there that we're not aware of or something that a company is perhaps working on that they haven't released yet? And because we had just made a name for ourselves with winning this Oscar, but we also made a name for ourselves in the 3D printing world, frankly, because we are a pretty unique user of their technology, but we also use a lot of resin. So when we were producing some of our movies like The Box Trolls, we were the number one consumer of color 3D printed material in the world. So I like to think it was that we were so creative and the companies really wanted to work with us, but I think it had to do with that we were potentially spending a lot of money on their materials. So we reached out to Stratasys again, this company that we'd had over a decade of working with, and asked them, hey, Stratasys, do you guys have anything that you're working on that you haven't released? And they had this three-color plastic printer that they were releasing. Now, it's only three colors. So that means that you could only choose to put three colors in the machine and mix those three colors. The other thing with it was that there was no real way of assigning color. The only way you could assign colors was through shell assignment, which means it's sort of like paint by number. You can go in and say, I want this part to be red and this part to be pink. And that was really time-consuming and sort of impossible for us to be able to get the sophisticated paint jobs that we were used to with the old powder printing technique. So we went to Stratasys and we said, hey, we think your hardware is really interesting. It's got a lot of potential, but the software that runs the printer stinks. Will you let us develop our own software to run the printers? And it's a little bit like going to Apple and saying, hey, we love your iPhone, but we hate your operating system. But Stratasys was more than willing. We had a long relationship with them, and they were eager to see what we could do. So basically, this slide here talks about what most consumers could do with this printer. They could go through and choose to pick any one of these colors, and they could print solid colors. Well, what we wanted to do is we wanted to be able to find a way to expand those colors from just the 46 that you could choose to over 256. Then we wanted to find a way that you could use a texture map to actually have a really artistic paint job that then you could wrap back around the 3D printed material, or wrap back around the 3D printed shape. So we not only needed to find a way technically to do it, but we also had to find a way to make sure that the director was going to buy off on having their characters be somewhat limited in the color gamut that they could have. But I think we're pretty successful. It's really hard to tell that Beetle was made up of only three colors in his face, and Monkey is the same. Monkey is only three colors. So we were really excited by how successful these guys ended up looking. But the whole reason we jumped into this endeavor was to be able to get that tiny little nose on Beetle's face, or those little angles there, or the hair on Monkey. If we had done that in the powder printing, they would have had to look completely different. So we are animating in the computer. We have a CG animating team that sits down and creates literally hundreds and thousands of facial expressions. We still are doing all of the internal components. This is an exploded view of Monkey's head. You can see all of the hardware inside there, the nuts and bolts. But instead of sending faces for Monkey to a powder printer, we were sending them to a resin printer. And what this resin printer does, I'll show you. It does not print that fast. That probably took about 12 or 14 hours to do. That was a time lapse. So what that resin printer is doing is it's spraying down liquid resin, and then bright UV lights are curing the resin. At the same time it's spraying the resin, it's also spraying that pink-looking gelatinous material. That's the support material that you saw come off in a really artistic way and spread out all over the printing tray. That's the support material. And that's there to help really create complex shapes. So this is a quick, short video to talk about us taking this technology of 3D printing plastic and being able to produce Moonbeast, which is our first fully 3D printed puppet. And I think someone here was asking which puppet was fully 3D printed, and this is the guy. So I'm going to play this quick video.
The climax of the film centers around an epic battle between Kubo and the dreaded Moonbeast. The rapid prototyping team had written their own 3D printer software, allowing them for the first time to print highly complex colored plastics. By developing this 3D printing software, the filmmakers could control material and color placement on the voxel level. Over 150 body parts were designed, sculpted, and texture painted in the computer and then 3D color printed out of plastic. Each 3D printed body segment was then backed with gold mylar and assembled around a gooseneck armature, allowing for smooth sweeping animation and subtle control. The puppet was built at 1/5 scale and animated with multiple camera setups and an elaborate rigging system. The camera team had to create a separate workflow for shooting this character to hold focus and achieve a deep depth of field. They accomplished this by cropping a usable 3K image out of the 5K RAW file, as opposed to resizing the full chip image to the working size of 2K. In order to realize the desired look and work around the 3D printer's limited color gamut, the RP, camera, and VFX departments worked together to come up with the right formula of color 3D printed materials, lighting, and a digital post process. The puppet was shot on green screen and photographed under three different lighting scenarios. Two white light passes were layered and combined before passing through a multi-step color process. An ultraviolet pass brought out the edge lines on his body, adding a radiating cyan glow. Using Oscar award-winning RP facial animation technology, over 1,417 moon beast mouths were printed, taking more than 147 days of round-the-clock printing.
Then I'll just have to rip it out of your head again.
So, thanks. Paranorman went on to be nominated for Best Animated Feature. Like all of Laika's films, we've been nominated for Best Animated Feature. But Kubo also went on to be nominated for Best Visual Effects. So it was the first time an animated movie had ever been nominated in both the animated film category and the visual effects category. Thank you. So, everything I'm going to talk about now is a little bit of a teaser to our next movie. This is the new technology we're using for the next movie. So remember I was talking about the printers, the Stratasys machines only had three colors. Well, we recognized that their entry into the market was sort of dipping their toe in the water. We knew that you could not have a color printer with only three colors for very long. So they started coming out with a machine called, it was codenamed Cachette, and it was a six-color machine. We started doing early beta testing in 2015. And similar, we had done a similar thing with Stratasys where we'd recognize that, hey, we have a real power and we really enjoy being able to create our own software to run the machines. So we sort of embarked on a similar relationship for this Cachette machine. And these are two little slides. One is to show, you know, where the state of the union was of color printing. This is the input image. This is what we would send to the printer. And this is what the printer would kick out. And you could see that there was some colors that were decent, but there was a lot of this rippling. There was a lot of these colors that were out of gamut that the machine couldn't produce. So we had heard about a research facility in Germany. This research facility had been playing around with a way of handling this voxelization or this way of handling advanced colors in a 3D printer. And the software that they had created is called Cuttlefish. And Cuttlefish allowed us to, here's that same input image, and here is how Cuttlefish would produce the actual 3D printed part. So it was a lot closer and to what the input image was. So long story short, it's very complicated, but we ended up going with Stratasys' hardware and partnering with this research facility and using their software. Now, I don't know how many of you guys were here earlier when Brian from Intel was talking about voxels. Was anyone here for that presentation? So he was talking about voxels, and I'm going to talk about voxels. It's basically the exact same thing. A voxel is a three-dimensional pixel. So for the first time, we are able to produce voxel printing, where we're actually, and it's kind of hard to see here, but the way that these color plastic faces are actually printed is they are not mixing those six colors. You're not taking a cyan and a magenta and mixing them to create an orange, or you're not taking a white and a black and mixing them to produce a gray. You're taking a solid droplet of black and a solid droplet of white, and you're putting them very close together on a voxel level. And these are voxels are extremely small. In a cubic centimeter, there's like 14 million voxels. And when you stand back and you look at that object, it gives you the appearance that those colors are actually mixed. So this is really sort of weird to look at, but believe it or not, this is a slice of some faces that are in progress of being printed. And you can see these tiny little dots. Those dots each represent a voxel. It looks a little bit like a pointillist painting, where when you get close to it in the museum, you see thousands of drops of color, and when you stand back, they all sort of blend together. So this really creepy guy over here that is not related to any of our movies, I'll show you anyone who wants to come see it. It's really unnerving. It's this bald head guy. That has 19 billion voxels in it. So we are actually able to control not only the outside of the head, but the entire inside of the head. I could geek out on voxels for a long time, but I'm running out of time. We ended up using our own software to take these slices and combine it on the rendering farm and be able to create, we'll skip over that stuff. It's kind of boring. I'm running out of time because Steve's got some amazing stuff. We got the first five machines off the assembly line in early 2016 of this new hardware, and it ended up being called the J750. and that's what we are using to produce all the faces for our current production. Before I end, I just want to give, we have one more video to show, but on Coraline, we produced about 20,000 faces for the entirety of the movie. For Kubo and the Two Strings, we produced about 64,000 faces for the entire movie. And on Missing Link, we have 102,000 faces. So we continue to raise the bar of what's possible within stop motion animation and 3D printing, but it's all there to really service the story, and it's all there to, you know, make the audience members get completely engrossed and forget that they're watching these little 9-inch inanimate objects come to life. So we have a quick little video here before I hand it off to Steve to talk about all the other things that the RP or the Rapid Prototyping Department has done over the years. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name's Steve. I'm the visual effects supervisor at Laika. You're probably asking yourself, what is visual effects' role when you're creating a stop-motion movie? It's an art that is over 100 years old, so what are these artists behind the scenes with the computers doing to contribute to that filmmaking process? Well, surprisingly, we do a lot on these films. I mean, for starters, if we're just talking about animation, let me figure out this clicker here. Obviously, with the performances that the animators are pushing into these puppets, one frame at a time, we do pursue a lot of realism and a lot of subtlety. And the way that we get there oftentimes is by using these pretty complex rigging systems. They're also used oftentimes when you have to defy gravity, if a puppet's going to jump, if it's going to throw a stick through space. All of these need to be painted out using a computer after the facts. After the fact, visual effects handles that. We also, as Brian had mentioned with the RP replacement faces, they are animated using separate brows versus the bottom of the faces. So when those are snapped on and off per frame during the film, they're going to leave a little seam line down the center. So same deal, we go in after the fact, we paint those out. But beyond that, what I'd like to say about visual effects at Laika is that what we're doing is we're enabling storytellers, right? If you want to make a stop-motion film, like let's say we're going to make a stop-motion film and it's going to be a guy standing up on a stage at the AT&T Shape Conference wearing a jacket that his wife bought him last night because she wants him so desperately to be fashionable. This thing's got to be built. The stage has got to be built. All the monitors have to be built. All of the chairs that you're sitting on, every stitch of clothing that you're wearing, all of that needs to be manufactured and created before we can even start animating one frame at a time over the course of years, right? So what this means, if you're a storyteller, if you're a director, and you want to do something in the stop-motion genre, immediately you're going to be asked to make some concessions. You're going to be asked to simplify, right? Because you can't get everything and still be responsible with the budget. Well, the idea at Laika was that we were going to leverage technology in order to be able to eliminate those concessions, all right? But we wanted to do it in a way that was informed by, and ultimately, a way that honored stop-motion filmmaking, all right? So, Kubo and the Two Strings. Here's the visual effects work that we did on this film. We did set extensions, extras, crowds, fire, smoke, moonbeast goo, destruction, cosmetic work, eyelid blending, rig removal, and multi-scale compositing with digital highlights. Digital elements. There was one thing that we did on Kubo and the Two Strings that was a really, really, really unique challenge, and it had to do with water. And if you think about water, it's always been something that's been somewhat troubling for stop-motion filmmakers because you can't grab a hold of it, you can't pose it, you can't move it one frame at a time. It'll just roll through your fingers and dry up. But we dealt with water before in previous films at Laika. Up here in the upper left side, those are 3D printed cycles that Brian and his team did that would be replaced using replacement animation one frame at a time. They printed up the cycles, animator swaps them out. We have a shower head that's spraying water on the coralline. In Paranorman, we had example there, overflowing toilet. The water that's coming over the side of the toilet there, that's all 3D printed replacement animation. The water on the floor, that's actually being done with KY jelly. That's being formed and posed one frame at a time by the animators. And in the bottom there, what's interesting about that example from the Box Trolls is we'd gone after that using 3D replacement animation. And then ultimately, the filmmaker wasn't entirely satisfied with the result, wanted a little bit of realism. So that was our first instance of doing CG replacement water in a Laika film. So when the filmmakers, three, four years ago, came to me and they said, we're going to do some water in Kubo, I was like, all right, let's do some water in Kubo. Right, we've got it down. We've done shower heads. We've done toilets. We've done splashes. And then he sat me down, and he showed me some storyboards. And I'm going to share that with you right now. These are animatics. So basically, they're animated storyboards with sound. And basically, we use these as a tool to plan for the film production. So this is what I saw that day. And this is sound.
If you must blink, do it now. Careful attention to everything you see and hear. No matter how unusual it may seem. Please be warned, if you fidget, if you look away, if you forget, any part of what I tell you, even for an instant, then our hero will surely perish.
Yay. All right, so we wrapped up the meeting. This was my expression, by the way. But we're going to get to work. We're problem solvers. We're innovators. We're artists. We're gonna move this art of stop motion animation forward. But as we often say, we're going to move forward, but we're going to look backward. And we're going to learn from the people before us. And we're going to engage all the artisans at Laika to figure this thing out. So the way we go about it, it starts with art. We fall in love with a piece of art. This is as analog and as 2D as it gets. We're going to look at this image, and we're going to work to bring it to life. But before we even boot up a single computer and start doing things digitally, the next thing that we do is we go out on the stages and we start working with the animators and the rigging teams, and we start developing physical, practical examples of water systems. Because we want to make sure that ultimately, whatever it is we create, it feels like it needs to be on target in terms of design, it needs to feel tactile, it needs to feel like it belongs in this world. So this is a theater-style water system, wasn't quite right. But then when we started animating using this iron grid of sorts and draping different types of materials over the top of it, one thing that everybody got really excited about was this scoop patterning that was created when we laid garbage bags over the top. And so immediately we're like, that looks amazing, it's beautiful. And so that gets folded into the water system. Then we start talking about other components. We start talking about churn and spray and white caps and everything needed to be designed and needed to be built physically. This is water churn that was created by the art department team using cut-up pieces of paper. That gets folded into the water system. And then, about a year later, we finally say, this is it, it's ready for the movie. Animators start animating, and when they're done, we get this. We're telling stories. And the story here is the monkey is battling a sister on a boat in the midst of a raging sea. We're not quite there yet. We're going to enable storytellers with visual effects, and this is the final result as it went into the film just over a year later. It's pretty cool, huh? So that was a lot of work. So what I want to show you now, and then we're going to start wrapping this up. I got to show you a couple of just other quick things. This is, not a lot of folks have seen this, it's going to be a side-by-side of the opening of Kubo. On one side, you're going to see all of the raw animation as it was delivered to visual effects when it came off of the stages. A lot of green screens, right? And then on the opposite side, you're going to see the final shots. So here is the opening of Kubo. Raw animation versus finals.
If you must blink, do it now. Pay careful attention to everything you see and hear. No matter how unusual it may seem. please be warned. If you fidget, if you look away, if you forget any part of what I tell you, even for an instant, then our hero will surely perish. Father stole something from him. And that really is the least of it.
Hey. Enabling storytellers, moving forward, looking backward, artisans collaborating with technologists, and that's what we got. And we're all really, really proud of it. So I got to wrap things up. But in doing so, the last thing I want to talk about is just the animators. And the animators are really, they're the rock stars of the studio. They're the ones that are breathing life into these characters. These are the ones that are hopefully enabling audiences to empathize with a 9-inch puppet by pushing life into them one frame at a time. So it's really them that we lean on in the end to try and move these audiences emotionally. So as a tribute to the Laika animators, and also because it's just so darn cool, I want to show you some animator time lapse of them bringing the characters from Laika's films to life.
Thank you. You ever think about the universe, Mr. Trout? What if our world is just like a tiny speck?
A tiny little speck.
And they're a giant looking down on us.
And every time we move...
It's actually them moving us.
Seems a bit tedious.
Like that, just there, me blinking. That would have taken them a day.
Me moving my arm. 500 men.
I mean, none of them are going home. They're having to do this bit. And now this bit. And this bit. I mean, this should stop.
All right, so we are out of time, but Brian and I, we're going to be hanging out afterwards. We brought some of the stars from the films here today. Please come up, have a look. We'd happily answer any other questions that you might have. A reminder to you, our fifth film, Missing Link, will be in theaters next spring, 2019. It is as ambitious as Kubo was. This thing, it blows it out of the water. It is a raucous comedy, globe-trotting adventure. We've got Hugh Jackman, Zach Galifianakis, Zoe Saldana as our voice cast. We put everything into this film. Please come out and enjoy it next spring. Tell all your friends. Thank you so much for coming today.